The second doctrine I want to give attention to is what theologians call the sanctification process. That's a fancy way of saying being changed. In our text today, he's saying we are being changed from glory to glory. From glory to glory. Do you know that when you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, the scripture says you are already glorified? In other words, you have every resource, everything you need within you through the Spirit of God to be have all the fullness of God. You can't add to that equation. There's nothing you can do to be more than what God has made you to be right now.
Abounding in Faith is the broadcast ministry of Emmanuel Bible Church of Howell, New Jersey. If you are blessed by this message, please subscribe to our podcast or YouTube channel. You can also download our app by searching for IBCNJ in the Google Play Store or the Apple Store. For more information, please visit us at www.ibcnj.org. Our speaker today is Senior Pastor Joe Suozzo.
That psalm always blessed me. I think of some of those verses. It says, when the righteous call out, the Lord hears them and delivers them out of all their troubles. I remember in India when I was going through just such a terrible time, I had to go to the mountains to refresh myself. It was just one of the more difficult breaking experiences of my youth. And in that psalm, the Lord says, the Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. Have you ever been there? Crushed? You know, the Lord speaks to us deeply in our times of being crushed. That's a time he can get our attention. You know, C.S. Lewis says that God's megaphone to a deaf world is suffering. He's close to those who are crushed in spirit. And then these verses, which always are so, hold so much promise for all of us, right? Many are the afflictions of the righteous. I think we can testify to that, right? Jesus said this way, he said, in this world you'll have troubles. Many of their afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them from them all. Isn't that the great Savior we serve, we love, we gather together to worship, that together we can affirm with one voice that he is a saving God, a mighty God, a God who can lift us up and deliver us. So wherever you are this morning, know this, we have a beautiful, good God who's able to save, wherever you are. This morning we're going to look at a few verses from 2 Corinthians, and if you have your Bibles with you, we're going to be looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 3, and particularly verses 16 through 18, and the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. For those of us who've confessed Christ, who believe in him as Savior, we have the wonderful gift of the Holy Spirit in us. And this is what we're reminded of. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 16 through 18. When one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. We all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another, for this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Father, we ask as we spend some time this morning meditating on these verses, you'd speak to our hearts. Lord, we need to hear you continually. You know how weary we get, for you are tempted in every way we are, yet without sin. And you can sympathize with every one of our weaknesses. We thank you for that. We pray as we meditate on these that you'd encourage our hearts and send us out of this place full, full, Lord, with the things of God. We pray in Christ's name, amen. So a couple questions I want us to discuss looking at these verses this morning. The first has to do with this. How are we changed by God from sinner to saint? You know, if you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, you are a saint. That's what the scripture teaches. It means the one who's set apart. So how are we changed with all the craziness that goes on in our lives, all the habits of thinking, all our personal struggles that each of us have, our pains, our dark thoughts, all of these things that all of us are tempted with. There's none of us here who get a pass on. How are we changed by God to be better people, to go from sinner, mired in darkness and sin, to become a people of joy and praise? That's the first question. We should be able to answer that, right? So I want us to visit this important truth of what is called regeneration. That each of us, when we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, we become regenerated, we become alive to the things of God. That's a wonderful truth. The second doctrine I want to give attention to is what theologians call the sanctification process. That's a fancy way of saying being changed. In our text today, he's saying we are being changed from glory to glory. From glory to glory. Do you know that when you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, the scripture says you are already glorified? In other words, you have every resource, everything you need within you through the Spirit of God to have all the fullness of God. You can't add to that equation. There's nothing you can do to be more than what God has made you to be right now. And then to glory means we have this wonderful place that God has promised. It's a resurrected, glorious future where sin will be no more. Every revelation says every tear will be wiped away. Every pain removed. That's good news for some of us, right? No more pains, aches. That's something we should be looking for. From glory to glory. That's what Scripture promises. And so let us look at these truths together. So let's begin with the regeneration of the Holy Spirit. Every one of us, and I think we can attest to that, if you're a born-again believer here this morning, everyone can attest that at one point in time, you needed a veil removed from your eyes. Scripture says here, when you turn to the Lord, the veil is removed. Paul's talking, the Apostle Paul, about what happens when a person receives Jesus Christ as their Savior and is born again. When we trust Jesus for the forgiveness of sin and call out to him for salvation, the Bible tells us the Spirit of God removes the blinders from our eyes that we may begin to see the things of God. This is a glorious truth. The amazing grace, which we sing from time to time. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. Such a basic, simple truth, right? The imagery Paul's using here, if you look at the entire context of this particular passage, is an account from Exodus when Moses returns from Mount Sinai after 40 days in prayer. That's a long time. Fasting, too. The only other record we have of one fasting for that period of time is Jesus Christ himself. He comes down from Mount Sinai and he has in his hands the laws of God to govern, to help govern and shape and guide the nation of Israel. And the glory of God is so much on him that they had to put a veil over his face because the people could not behold him. That's how glorious it is. And that's where Paul's getting this imagery from. They couldn't bear the glory of God. They couldn't see God. They needed a veil from their eyes to be removed. That's what Paul's using here. He's trying to teach them that before the Spirit of God touches a person, before we're born of God's Spirit, man is blind to the things of God. If you look at the text a few verses earlier, he writes that before the Spirit of God indwells a person, look at the imagery here. Man's mind is hardened. Hardened. That means it's impervious to the truths of God's word. Maybe you have a friend or a family member or someone close to you who just is unable to see truth. They just can't see it. They don't see that the most important thing they need is the person of Jesus Christ in their life. Their minds are hardened. They need to be touched by the Spirit of God. You are not going to be able to, no matter what words you use, I'm not saying that words are not important. We proclaim Christ, but you're not going to physically will a person to be changed. The Spirit of God must do that. I had a great friend who was had evangelistic zeal. That's all I can call it. He was so desirous for his family coming to the Lord. You know what he did? He took tracts and he would put them in the toilet paper. So when they were taking the toilet paper out, the tract would come out. It really wasn't working. They're like, what? They knew where it came from. I'm not saying that we shouldn't bear witness to truth. I'm just reminding us that it's the Spirit of God that opens the heart and the mind of the individual. Look at verse 16, 17. When one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Freedom for what? To see the things of God. You're not free man if you don't see the things of God. You know, America, we talk about freedom all the time, right? Someone bought me a t-shirt. On one side, it says freedom with an American flag. The other side, it says 45, which is an allusion to Trump. I don't wear it because I don't want to get into political. I want Christ to be first that people see, not my political affiliation. So I don't wear it because I don't want that discussion. But America, you know, we're shouting it, freedom, freedom, freedom. But people don't really know what true freedom is, because freedom, true freedom, and this is what our founders had an idea, was to give the possibility that man could see the things of God. That's why our First Amendment talks about the freedom to gather. To gather to do what? To hear truth. See, not every nation has that freedom to hear truth. A lot of people are suffering in this world under persecution. Places in Africa, the Middle East. I think it's people are free in the Middle East to gather in the name of Jesus? No, they are not. You think they're free in China? No, they are not. So the freedom that he's talking about here is the freedom to see the things of God. He's also alluding here, Paul, to the inability of the old covenant, that's the law of Moses, to lead a person to have a relationship with God. You know, when Israel was under the law did not bring freedom and salvation, but it brought condemnation. The laws of God does not bring freedom, it brings condemnation. It's the Spirit of God working through the gospel of Jesus Christ that brings us freedom. What the law does is it tells us that not to covet, not to steal, not to lie. And all the law does is reveal to the sinner that they're liars, that they're covetous, that they're jealous. And so the law's purpose was to show man sin. It wasn't to provide freedom. And so he's talking about that in this passage. The purpose of the law for Israel was that they would see their sin. That's why they had a sacrificial system. If you look at the laws of Moses, which is particularly in the book of Exodus, Numbers, and Leviticus, there's a tremendous amount of blood in those passages. And all those blood sacrifices were pointing to Christ, who would be the final sacrifice. So redemption, forgiveness of sin, is found through the shedding of blood, which was a shadow in the Old Testament, fulfilled in Christ. And when we turn to him, we're forgiven of our sin. Good news. Indwelt by the Holy Spirit. Good news. Given new life. Good news. And now we're free from condemnation from God. We're no longer under the wrath of God, under his judgment. That's the gospel. Now, when we gather, I hope you have a sense of joy in that, because that eclipses all of our difficulties and trials in this life. I know some of you are going through a hard time. This is greater than that, whatever you're going through. Bible teaches that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, but here, look at 2 Corinthians 3:17, but when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. I love it. Well, let's just talk about this idea of beholding the glory of God for a moment. He transitions in verse 18 to describe what I call the sanctification process, or how God changes us from being conditioned by sin to now being conformed into the image of his Son, Jesus. Look at the text. It says, we all, that's those who put their faith in Jesus, beholding the glory of God, are being transformed, being changed. The idea of beholding the glory of God here is instead is the ability or the freedom to behold God's presence, his will, his word, which remains hidden to us before Christ. But now, through Christ, all those things are available to us. That is how change begins in our lives. This is how we begin to understand the things of God. The only way we can be free from guilt and shame is to discover that freedom and innocence is available from the Lord. The only way we can go from being delivered from bitterness and unforgiveness and anger, which our hearts are so captured by at times, is from the Lord. The only way we're going to truly move beyond our anxieties and our fears that we all struggle with is from the Lord. But here's our problem. This is our problem. We have a lot of competing voices going on in our head, don't we? How would you like, and I've said this before, and I said I would never do it, but imagine just my thoughts from the last day plastered all over this wall. It would be an ugly sight. Any of us, right? We have so many competing voices. And sometimes these are voices that promise change, things, these are deceptions, but they fail to deliver. Let me give you an example. The predominant voice in today's culture is a voice that leaves God out of the equation. Doesn't take much ingenuity to figure that out. Just look at the media. In fact, you watch a movie and you say, how could they not put God in this movie? And, you know, it's always man delivering man. And the predominant voice is that somehow man or I myself can change myself. Now, the self-esteem movement is the most obvious example of that. If I think I am a good enough, think about this. This is self-esteem now. If I think I'm a good enough person, full of virtue and potential, then that very thought of how I perceive myself will be sufficient enough to change me into the person I need to be. Did you hear what I said? If you go to a secular counselor, that's exactly where they're going to try to lead you, who is called cognitive therapy. They're going to say, your problem is self-think. You know, you got to get rid of all that negative thoughts about yourself. Well, let me explain something to you. If you're a sinner, wouldn't before a holy God and needing a repair, wouldn't that be the most important thing you need to hear? If I tell myself I'm good when I'm not good, how does that lead me to truth and freedom? It does not. These therapies hold out the promise through the counseling process and drug therapy at times. We'll become increasingly aware of the lies and the mistruths we speak to ourselves and lead us to positive change. I'm not saying some of that isn't good, because some of it is biblically based. But the problem with self-esteem movement is that it assumes that within man there's an ability to be free and truly transformed. We can't transform ourselves. That's the biggest lie that the devil, that's what the lie that the devil told Eve from the beginning at the garden. Another deception, and I have to approach this because we're in church, is religion. Some people think that just being religious is going to change them. That was the problem with the Jewish people. They began to look to the law for salvation instead of God for salvation. And so we have various, I remember when I was growing up in a church, family was a mess, absolute bastion of conflict and craziness, and we'd all go to confession every week. And I'd go into the confessional booth, you know, confess my sin as a young boy, and I'd get whatever, certain prayers, and, you know, I'd feel good for about 5 minutes. Because the process, the religious process, wasn't bringing me to a place of freedom and understanding of who I really was. When we were in India, of course, we worked amongst the Hindu people, and it was amazing. We lived near this river, the Ganges, one of the most famous rivers in India. So many people would go to that river believing that if they just go into that river, that would cleanse them from sin. But it didn't change them inside. These were just religious acts. You see, the gospel is different than religion or psychology. The gospel of Jesus Christ states that when we receive and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins, that God's Holy Spirit begins to live within us and change us from the inside out, from glory to glory. When we're in Christ, we're declared by God forgiven, innocent, blameless, given the title saint in the scriptures now, and the promise of transformation and change. That's what it means to be born again. Gospel teaches that the power of the Holy Spirit, through his power, God can change us. Now, here's the question now. This will bring me to my second point. I want you to listen. Why do so many of us struggle to be the kind of people God wants us to be? Instead of victory and joy, why is there so much defeat and a pattern of sin? Instead of peace and a sense of well-being, why do so many believers struggle with anxiousness and confusion? How do we get out of that pattern? How do we break these patterns of sinful habit? Well, that's called the process of sanctification that comes through the power of the Spirit. Now, here's our number one problem. You ready? If you're taking notes, you can write it down. We're not listening. You just talk to my wife. She says, he's not listening. She's trying to get my attention, tell me important message, not listening. Now, I'm not going to be able to do what she's asking me to do if I'm not. So she's patient. She's like a saint in hell, and she just says, Joe. And then finally I'm out of my stupor. And I'm listening. We're not listening to God and allowing, instead we're allowing other voices, our own voices, to fill our hearts. Sometimes these are voices of doubt, where we struggle to accept the things of God. Sometimes they're voices from the culture around us, the world around us that promise a good life outside of God Himself. Sometimes there are voices within that are filled with fear, confusion, that lead us to behaviors like addiction and anxiety. How do we stop and listen to God? That's really our biggest question. Now, God has spoken, by the way. We got 66 books here. He spoke through the prophets, through the apostles, through Christ Himself. So we have His voice here. You go out, and these days, with this nice summer weather, especially the last few days, we have a little patio in my townhouse, and my wife's made wonderful. There's flowers and a bird feeder. Just sit out there and watch nature. God's speaking. He's speaking. But our problem is we're not listening. Well, how do you listen? You have to stop. You have to stop what you're doing. This is a problem in New Jersey culture. We're going at 100 miles an hour, and we don't even know what the heck is going on. We're just going from one thing to another. Do you know God gives you the permission to stop? You can stop. And believe it or not, the world will keep on spinning round and round. The world is not depending on you going, 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 going. What is the most... When you ask somebody how they're doing in New Jersey, what's the most common response? Oh, busy, busy. It's impossible to go about a busy schedule and allowing our hearts to be filled 24/7 with the buzz of especially the media. This is a big, big culprit right here. I have a book in my library called The 12 Destructive Things That a Cell Phone Will Do to You. Can't even get in my pocket anymore. They're so big. We have to stop. Now, interestingly, God gave 10 commandments to Moses when he came down. One of those commandments is the Sabbath rest. The Sabbath rest. Sabbath, in the original Hebrew language, means to cease, stop. That's literally what it means. It has the idea of ceasing from our work, our busy lives and responsibilities, and giving attention to God. Sabbath keeping was God's gift to His people, where they were given permission to stop, give attention to the things of God, and allow God to fill them with a sense of purpose and direction and peace as they face the other 6 days. I'm a little envious at times of my Hasidic friends down the street and our Orthodox community. Now, mind you, they have to do it or they receive the scorn of the entire community. Here we have a very loose way of understanding the Sabbath, right? If I can fit church in, right? Sometimes is our mentality. But really, the Sabbath from God is a gift. It wasn't a mandate. It wasn't just a law to be kept out of some sheer duty because I have to stop. Now, interestingly, the religious leaders and priests of Jesus' day were in conflict with Jesus a lot about the Sabbath. They believed in keeping the Sabbath was a way for them to be right with God. That's where they got it wrong. Sabbath keeping wasn't a way to be righteous with God. Sabbath keeping was a gift from God that we may spend time with Him. So they created, for their own righteousness, the religious leaders, Talmudic teaching, 600 plus laws around the Sabbath. It's a lot of laws, everything from eating and all kinds of things. Now, when Jesus was here for the 3 years in ministry, He broke some of those 600 laws because they were not of God. They failed to understand the purpose of Sabbath. Jesus healed different people on the Sabbath. He allowed the disciples to break the Sabbath when they picked some kernels of wheat to eat, which was deemed as working. He gave them permission to eat without washing hands on the Sabbath. Various portions of the gospel tell us that they were so upset with Jesus about him breaking Sabbath, they wanted to kill him. So you can imagine they felt pretty strongly about this. But I love Jesus' teaching. Mark 2:27, Jesus said it this way, "The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath." What was Jesus teaching there? Sabbath wasn't there to bring them into right relationship with God, but God gave Sabbath to man to have the freedom to stop from his work, be refreshed and replenished with the things of God. You know what our fastest growing religion in America is today? I'll be talking more and more about this. I'm really thinking a lot about this as we look at the future. The nuns, not N-U-N-S, N-O-N-E-S, fastest growing religion in America. A Z millennial generations from the ages, I think, 13 to 37 now, 38 or whatever it is, fastest growing religion. Almost 40% of that younger generation are heading towards what is called no religious affiliation, no faith, no belief in anything. Fastest growing idea in America is atheism. Well, we know where they got that from. Just look at your public school institutions and how they systematically remove God from them. The problem with our culture and for the nuns is, you know, you remove a community of faith like church, then there's no community, no hope, no substance. That's where our generation is. And you wonder why anxiety is never at a higher level. It's in shambles. We need revival. You see, if we're unwilling to stop in our day or our week to cultivate a listening heart to the things of God, we'll not hear him, and the worries of our heart, the busyness and noise around us will be the only things we hear. That's why the two most important things that you could be involved in your week, and I'm going to tell you right now, is your personal daily time with God, number one. To stop, to read scripture, and to pray, and ask God to set your heart for the rest of the day in the right direction. If you're waking up, drinking coffee, and running 100 miles an hour, and you're out like the hamster on the treadmill, and you think that, oh, somewhere in the midst of this, I'm going to stop. No, you are not. So my counsel is set the alarm 15 minutes earlier and stop. Start your day. Spend a couple days. Daniel, the prophet, prayed 3 times a day. Why not? It doesn't have to be this long. Just set your heart on the things of God. Personal time with God. That's number one. The second thing is here, what we're doing here. Worshiping together, serving together, being a witness to the world together. You see, these two habits of Sabbath keeping and ceasing and being part of a community of faith is God's way so that our hearts are listening to him and we gain greater victory over sinful habits and sinful thoughts. I want to just finish with these three things. I call them aspects of transformation. So you're going to stop, right, after my sermon. You're going to take time to be with God. And let me tell you, these are the three things which are happening in a lot of your lives. I know that already. But there are three things that are what I call the tangible evidence that the Spirit of God is working in you. I'm going to tell you about them right now. When the Holy Spirit's filling us and changes us into the kinds of people God wants us to be, the first thing is going to be an increasing conviction of sin. That we would have a sense that God wants me to go this way. So you know what repentance means? Repentance means to change one's mind about something. So I have several things that I ask God every day for victory over when I get started. Things that I'm tempted by, things that I'm led by. No, Lord, I don't want to go that. I want to go your way, not my way. So the Spirit, Scripture teaches, brings conviction of sin. That means you have a sense of that something's wrong. You know, before Christ, when I was in my hippy-dippy days, you know, doing things that I'm not going to discuss, but were clearly wrong, it was interesting to watch how God was putting his finger. No, not that, this. No, not that, this. No, not that. And I had a choice. Am I going to go God's way or am I going to continue to go my way? And conviction of sin always leads to repentance, and repentance always leads to greater and greater victory over sin. It's a process that you're going to be going through for the rest of your days on earth. I love later on Corinthians, earlier on actually in the first letter, he says, godly sorrow produces repentance unto salvation without regret, but worldly grief produces death. 1 John chapter 3, we read these words, little children, whoever practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. But whoever makes a practice of sinning is of the devil, for the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God came was to destroy the works of the devil. Those are those works in us that are counter to the things of God. So the first thing is conviction of sin and increasing victory over sinful habits. The second sign of being filled with the Holy Spirit is evidence of the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit. When we look to God's Word, especially Galatians 5, some of us have those spiritual fruits memorized. We begin to tack away from the practice of sin, and instead of anger and addiction and jealousy and sexual immorality and greed, as believers, we're filled with the Holy Spirit and an increasing sense of peace, joy, love, kindness, gentleness is in me. That's great news. Against such things, Scripture says there is no law. In other words, there's no condemnation on those things, and so consequently, there's freedom. Don't be a joyful person. You ever hear that in Scripture? Don't be at peace with yourself. No. Don't be kind. Don't be gentle. Be rude, be obnoxious, be uncaring, be selfish. No, that's our sinful flesh speaking. But God wants us to be freedom. For this reason, Galatians says, you've been called to be free to love one another. Now, this doesn't mean, by the way, you're going to be perfectly patient, perfectly joyful, perfectly patient. So my patience is being tested right now. It's for me. If we're failing in a given area, right, lacking joy or peace, struggling with loving others, it only shows God is not in control and the Spirit is not having his way in us, and we continue to press on. You know, we're going to be perfected from glory to glory on the day Christ comes back. That's going to be glorious, when sin is no more. That day is not today. Today is a day of struggle. But we can tack away from sin and tack towards the things of God. That is through the agency and the power of the Holy Spirit. A final area of the Spirit's work in our lives is our willingness to serve God. We talked a little bit about this, I believe, 2 weeks ago when I was discussing the talents from the parable of the talents in Matthew chapter 25. And I always found it interesting, you know, he gives talents, 5 talents to one person, 2 talents to another, and 1 talent to another, each according to his ability. That's what the text says. Each according to his ability. That means everyone has been given something. Even the one person with the least amount of talent has been given a talent. And everyone will be held to account on that. So it's incumbent upon you as a follower of Jesus Christ to ask the question, God, what would you want me to do with these few days that you have given me on earth to bless your name in Jesus' name? That's the question that you'd be asking. If the Spirit is working, you will find a sense of purpose in this life. Guaranteed. We're having a meeting on Tuesday, a group of leaders and I. We're going to start Celebrate Recovery in the fall, which is a Christ-based 12-step program for people who struggle with addictions. But it's not just for people with addictions. It's people who are struggling, period. And I'm curious and interested to see how that brings some of us out together to begin asking this question. What is your purpose for me? You know, your purpose may be just to come alongside one person and to be their advocate, to be their encourager. Not everyone's called to be here preaching, you know, but if you're here called to be preaching, you better be preaching. Whatever God's called you to do, you should be able to say with confidence, I hear you, Lord. I'm willing to go your way. That is what the Spirit of God does. We find in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Romans chapter 12, a very clear message from Scripture that everybody in the church has been given a gift to serve Him with. Some to teach, some to help, some have the ability to make money and give. Some are called to encourage others, to show mercy. Some have the ability to discern the true nature of what's going on in other people's lives. They're very empathetic and can speak deeply into people. So Paul writes, look again at the text, we all with unveiled faces, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed from one into the same image, from one degree of glory to another. This comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Now, last thing I'm going to talk about is this word transformation in the text. The original word here in the Greek language is the same word we use when describing how an ugly caterpillar worm goes through the transforming process of turning into a beautiful butterfly. Metamorphosis. That's literally what the Greek word is, metamorphosis. I can't say it in Greek. I can say it in English. It's a fitting word, since before Christ, we're like an ugly worm. That's the way I look at it. Without Christ, you're like an ugly worm. But now in Christ, through the working of God's Holy Spirit, we're transformed, going through the metamorphosis process from glory to glory. One degree of glory to another. Now, there's something that we all have heard about, right, with this worm that is transformed into a butterfly in this process of metamorphosis. When it's ready to come out of the cocoon, the struggle of breaking out and using its whatever muscles it has to break out of that cocoon gets it ready for a flight. Now, of course, as a little boy, I learned this when I was looking at this cocoon that seemed to be ready, and I just tore the thing open, and the poor butterfly just died. That's what little boys do. They kill little bugs. Don't ask me why we have that. It's sin. That's what I call it. But there is purpose in the struggle. That's my point. That's what I want to end with. You may be going through a struggle in this process of transformation. Well, welcome to the real world. Let me explain something to you. Your struggle, your sufferings, are not your enemy. They become a great tool by God when we invite Him in and allow the Holy Spirit to have His way in our lives. from glory to glory. And that includes all the promises that God's talking about. Isn't that good news? Let's pray. Father, we're grateful for this portion of Scripture and your kindness to us. All the ministry of the Holy Spirit in our lives to teach us, to guide us, to transform us. As Scripture says, for us to not be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. Help us, Lord, to be that kind of people. And so we pray for that. I pray for each person here. They can learn to stop, to listen to your voice. No sweeter, better voice is there, that we may be changed into the people that you want us to be. In Christ's name, amen.
Thank you for listening to the previous message. We pray that you were blessed by it. For more information, please visit us at www.ibcnj.org.